The day after John Paul XXIII died, NBC aired a second memorial program to the pontiff. The first program was broadcast the day before and was uploaded in a previous video. If you enjoy these videos, make sure that you give a thumbs up and subscribe.
After a dramatic four-day fight against a tumor, he suffered more than a year. Tributes from all over the world are flooding into the Vatican. And tonight, NBC News presents this special memorial on the life of Pope John.
Now and is no longer here. He reigned only a few years, yet in that brief time he became known and loved by millions. The great balcony of St. Peter's, from which he often blessed the faithful, is now empty, and the famous window in the Vatican apartment is vacant. Below, the immense square, embraced by the arms of the world's largest basilica, the huge piazza, so often filled with cheers, is now filled with a deep sadness, for a pope has died. For the millions who saw him, the most vivid memory of Pope John XXIII is as a ruling monarch, carried among his joyous faithful, richly robed and elevated, his warm presence filling St. Peter's and thrilling the subjects of his spiritual kingdom. The throne of Peter is one of great power, and a pontiff is a true ruler. But Pope John was also their beloved Il Papa, the Father, the Holy Father. As such, he was close to everyone, the lowborn and those of high station. A veteran diplomat himself, he knew the importance of making himself available to other envoys. Ambassadors to the Holy See, whether from Catholic or non-Catholic countries, recall his courtesy. One of 13 children, this pope had a special fondness for the ordinary family, and no cardinal, king, or president could bring forth the famous smile as easily as did a child. John XXIII did indeed suffer the little ones to come unto him. Not everyone who sought him out was in a happy state, and those who brought him their troubles, this pope had a ready and patient ear. He was equally kind to the very important persons, those visitors of great family and influence, and those national leaders who wielded great political power. His friendship with Charles de Gaulle went back to the dark days in France during the last war. He was a simple, kindly, and very human man with a tenderness of manner that put even a child at ease. He was the Bishop of Rome and the Vicar of Christ on earth. But he is also remembered as the good shepherd of his flock, the jovial, considerate pastor who, in the midst of his papal responsibilities, was still able to find the time to visit and comfort the sick. Other popes, in other times, have evoked awe and respect, but this pope also drew love and affection from the millions who looked upon him as the ruler of their church. As such, he ruled 500 million Catholics around the world and exhorted them to follow the teachings of Christ and the church. Even when surrounded with all the pomp of the Vatican, he was able to project his warmth as a man. He loved those in the crowd that paid him homage, for he was truly one of them. But he was also their bridge between earth and heaven. Popes are seldom young, their burdens are heavy, the road to Rome is long, and for Pope John, a longer road than most, a journey in time stretching back three quarters of a century, a lifetime which had its beginnings in a tiny village in northern Italy in the shadows of the mountains. Sotto il Monte is much the same as it was in 1881 when Angelo Giuseppe Roncalli was born. Peasant farmhouses sometimes breed revolutionaries. This one gave birth to a pope, and he credits the glory to his beloved father, Giovanni, a hard-working peasant farmer whose ancestors lived in the region for 500 years. and to his mother, Anna, who only hours after the birth carried her first son to the village church to be baptized. His two older sisters were to be his housekeepers during much of his priesthood. The Roncalli family was and still is very close. Several nieces are nuns, one of them serving in the missions in Africa. The family knew poverty, but shortly after becoming Pope, he once said, "We were poor but happy. We did not realize that we lacked anything, and in truth we did not, for we were rich in the gifts of heaven." The Roncallis were blessed with 13 children, and several of the Pope's brothers are still living. For them, life was to go on as it has for centuries in their part of Italy. Pope John had many of the same qualities as his hardy brothers. He had a peasant's robust physical stamina, accepting the papacy when he was almost 77 years old. And from such a family background, he also inherited a deep sense of reality and the natural shrewdness of an Italian peasant. But in at least one way, young Angelo Roncalli was to be different. Now, old men of the village, who were once his boyhood playmates, recall that Angelo was his father's favorite, and his parents felt that he should be given an education. The church dominated the life of the village. Its teachings were as food to a deeply religious people, and its bells reminding them of their obligations to God. For the Roncallis, this meant that their oldest boy must get an education, perhaps to be a priest. The nearest school was several miles away, and to it young Angelo walked each day, sometimes carrying his shoes. This was not heroic sacrifice, simply common sense to save the leather. He was not a brilliant student, just a normal boy, nothing extraordinary. Yet in these common classrooms, his teachers noted a boy of uncommonly good character and kindness. His parents felt they could get along without his help on the farmland. It was decided. At the age of 11, Angelo was going to study to be a priest. 10 years were to pass in the seminary at Bergamo. In its halls, the intellectual life was to unfold. He had found his way, and now improving in his schoolwork, he was sent on to Rome for advanced church study. A chance for future leadership was to be his. And it was in Rome, as this century opened, and after a dozen years of effort, that Angelo Roncalli was ordained. Then destiny beckoned. Instead of a parish assignment, the new bishop of Bergamo chose young Father Roncalli as his secretary, putting him into the mainstream of church life. He also taught in the same seminary where he himself had first studied to be a priest. His bishop had insight and saw in his aid the seed of greatness. During the next 10 years, he taught and traveled and learned how the church operates. But in Europe, the clouds of war were gathering over the continent, and in 1914, the Great War came. Father Roncalli was called up, serving as a chaplain in the medical corps. After the armistice, Pope Benedict summoned him to Rome and gave him the task of helping reorganize the section of the Curia which handles foreign missions. He did so well that at the age of 44, he was ready for bigger things. He was made a bishop and was now to begin his career as a papal diplomat. The assignment was one requiring great skill. He was made apostolic visitor to Bulgaria. That Balkan kingdom was in chaos after the war. Terrorists were assassinating officials. Roncalli's mission was twofold and complex. In Bulgaria, the Eastern Orthodox Church dominates. He was to care for the small Catholic population and at the same time work for a healing of the Orthodox schism with Rome. This labor for Christian reunion was to bear fruit in later days. He spent 20 years in the Byzantine world engaged in such activities. He traveled to every part of Bulgaria, meeting with Catholic and Orthodox officials, helping the refugees. Once during an earthquake, he personally rushed help to its victims. He stopped the practice of making Eastern Rite Catholics recite prayers in French or Latin and let them pray in their native tongues, and he learned Bulgarian himself. Though not an official diplomat, he was the first representative of a pope in Bulgaria in 600 years. And he did much to bring a rapprochement closer to reality. But now it was 1935, and another task of diplomacy needed his talent. Turkey was in need of a papal delegate, and Roncalli was the man for the job. A revolution had thrust Turkey out from under the old Ottoman Empire and into the status of a modern republic with Mustafa Kemal as its dictator. Turkey's small Catholic population needed a protector. Again, there was the chance to talk with Orthodox leaders. Greece was also Roncalli's responsibility, and he helped its war-ravaged people by getting food for them past the Allied blockade. World War II was drawing to a close when Pope Pius sent Roncalli to liberated Paris as his nuncio. France was torn apart internally. Free French leaders were determined to punish Marshal Pétain. The new provisional president, General de Gaulle, was angry because the Vatican's envoy had followed the Pétain regime to Vichy. But by sheer force of personality and with patient work, Roncalli straightened out the differences between Paris and the Vatican. Dealing with de Gaulle is a matter of delicate diplomacy, but Roncalli handled it well. He loved France and visited all the great shrines of that nation, at Reims and Lourdes. In the 8 years he was to spend in France, Archbishop Roncalli became well known to its people. He also knew their problems. Many had abandoned Catholicism. The worker priest movement, sending priests into factories to win back souls, was in operation. But some in the Vatican opposed it. Priests became involved in labor disputes, forgetting other priestly duties. While there was hostility in Rome, Roncalli was sympathetic and advised patience. Finally, the worker priest movement was modified, but without further estrangement of the French people. Once again, Roncalli had helped to restore peace within the church in France. A grateful pope named him a cardinal. Roncalli was so well-liked that French President Auriol, once a Marxist and a longtime socialist, claimed the privilege of personally placing the Beretta on his head. And a grateful France made the new cardinal a commander of the Legion of Honor. Along with the red hat went a new post. Cardinal Roncalli was made Patriarch of Venice. His entry was spectacular, for only Venice, steeped in history and tradition, and built like no other city in the world, could welcome its patriarch with a floating procession down the Grand Canal. Cardinal Roncalli was now 71 years old. Seeing the proud old palaces, the crowds, the splendors of this ancient town, he thought that here he would end his days. Here at last he could be a pastor and father to these, his beloved Italian people. He took up his seat of authority in the Basilica of St. Mark, a Byzantine glory recalling his earlier years in the Near East. But his residence was brief. The hand of Providence was moving. At Castle Gandolfo, Pope Pius XII was dying. Crowds in Rome, hearing the rumors of his death, poured into the streets to discover if they were true. After an agonizing death watch, the end had come. And from St. Peter's came the official announcement. Pius XII, after almost 20 years of rule, was dead. And now, cardinals would be called to a conclave to elect his successor. One of those summoned was now Angelo Cardinal Roncalli, who departed Venice for Rome. Taking only a few things with him and telling his people he would be back with them in 2 weeks. In Rome, the other princes of the church were also arriving. There was much speculation as to whom the new pope would be. There was the famous French Cardinal Tisserand. From the United States, New York's Cardinal Spellman had hurried back to Rome. There was the Armenian Cardinal Agajanian, the most prominent of the non-Italians. At 76, the Venetian, Roncalli, was the youngest of the older cardinals. But he was only briefly mentioned as a possible pontiff. There were several others given a better chance, and he drew no particular attention at the time. While the guessing game went on, other cardinals arrived until there were 52 of them in Rome, but America's Cardinal Mooney died before the conclave could begin. Then the long wait for a new pope. Outside the Sistine Chapel, the crowds gathered. Sealed inside, the cardinals voted. Rome and the world waited. 1 day passed, 2. A third day lengthened into night. and still the balloting continued and the crowds waited. A great drama was taking place, a secret election to raise one man to the throne of Peter for life. Suddenly it came, all eyes turned to the famous chimney, whose smoke this time, after 11 ballots, was white. But who was the new pope? The announcement came swiftly.
Eminentissimum, ac reverendissimum, dominum, angelum, Josephum, sante romane ecclesiae, cardinale Meroncalli.
Yes, Roncalli was the new pope. Now John the 23rd gave his first blessing to Rome and to the world.
Descendat super vos et maniat semper.
In the weeks that followed, prelates and dignitaries prepared for the coronation. Little was known about this pope. Other church figures overshadowed him in prominence. But now, for the first time, television was to cover the historic moment and make the new pope a familiar figure to the world. The climax to a glittering coronation came when the papal crown, the triple-tiered tiara, was placed on his head, the weight of his crown symbolic of the burdens of his holy office. The new pope was shy, but the faithful waited for his blessing, and he did not disappoint them.
Santi Apostoli Petrus et Paulus, decorum autoritate et potestate confidimus.
Now he was pope, and at 77 was well past an age when many men have retired. Though older at the time of his election than any pontiff in the last 230 years, John soon proved he did not intend to serve as just an interim pope until a younger leader could be chosen. Those first days in the Vatican were eventful ones. There was the primary duty of governing the church. The post of papal secretary of state had been vacant since 1944. It was quickly filled. Pius XII had let death dwindle the ranks of the College of Cardinals, but now Pope John moved swiftly, and in a surprise move, he named 23 new cardinals, raising their number to 75 for the first time in four centuries. The traditional regular meetings with the cardinals who guide the various congregations of the church were resumed. His ever-increasing sureness in bestowing the galero gave notice that his was to be a dynamic reign. He soon named even more cardinals, including the first Negro, Cardinal Rumgambwa of Tanganyika, saying, "To show that the church is alive, we have included the color black in the white of the Sacred College." The first Japanese and Filipino cardinals were also named. And Mexico received its first red hat. This raised the college to the unprecedented number of 86. The world was watching a pope in action. Yes, this was a progressive pontiff, and a very human one. He often left the Vatican, on one occasion making a very touching visit to a Roman prison. It was the first time in the modern age that anyone could recall a pope going to visit convicts. This simple act of kindness was to endear him to the world. But he put the prisoners at ease by stating simply, "You are all children of the Lord. You could not come to see me, so I had to come to see you." 1,500 prisoners never forgot this and never will. John the 23rd felt keenly about social problems. Mother and teacher, the longest encyclical in church history, came from his pen. In it, he urged the wealthier nations to help the underdeveloped countries. Always there was concern for these emerging nations. He was deeply interested in Africa and Asia, and went outside the Vatican to a seminary where young men from these regions were training to be priests. Only 8% of Africa is Catholic, and just over 2% of Asia's teeming millions. In these critical areas, communism sees many potential converts. The Pope exhorted these young soldiers of Christ, encouraged them in their labors, reminding them that soon they would be returning to their countries to the quiet but desperate battle for men's souls. Always there were the audiences, workers and pilgrims, children and religious, the devout families and the merely curious. Almost everyone who comes to Rome wants to see the Pope. Many hours are given over to these meetings. It is fatiguing and at times can exhaust a pontiff. But Pope John saw all who sought him out, rewarding each with a word, a gift, a gesture, or a smile. The visits from heads of state were vital. Pope John, having lived in the Muslim world, was well aware of its importance, and a chance to meet one of its leaders, the Shah of Iran, was welcomed. The Holy Father worked to relieve tension between Rome and the non-Catholic world, remembering when he served in the Near East, where Catholics are in the minority. He expressed great admiration for the United States and warmly received its then President Dwight Eisenhower. Ike and Pope John had much in common. Both came from large families and had known hardship in their youth. Each had deep love for his parents, had risen to positions of great power, yet each remained essentially a warm human being. One visitor drew more comment than most. He was Dr. Geoffrey Fisher, then Archbishop of Canterbury, the first primate of the Church of England to speak with a pope in almost 600 years. Their talk was unofficial but cordial, and his visit was a good omen for what was to be the most important event in church history in modern times, the Ecumenical Council.
It was the first such gathering in almost 100 years, the first of the space age. These pictures of the opening ceremony on October 11, 1962, were transmitted across the Atlantic via the communication satellite Telstar. Other popes have named cardinals or written encyclicals or given of themselves in audiences to the world. But very few decree that a worldwide council of the church shall take place. Pope John did so decree, and his act had far-reaching meaning for the Christian world. For among the topics discussed was that of possible reunion. Protestant and Orthodox churchmen were invited to observe, while more than 2,000 cardinals, bishops, and other prelates deliberated on the major questions confronting the church. 3.5 years of preparation had gone into the council, months of work on putting the giant basilica of St. Peter's into a state of readiness. The aisle of the great nave was flanked by temporary stands built for the occasion, and none of the 20 previous ecumenical council gatherings had required so much advance liaison with religious communities far from Rome. The work of the council was not to be accomplished in a single session. Several months of recess were arranged for the visiting prelates to report home and to reformulate their positions. In particular, it was Pope John's hope that the thousand-year schism between Rome and the Eastern Rite Catholics might be brought to an end, or at least that the possibility of reunion might be brought closer to reality.
In this 20th century, there have been six popes. Two have guided the Catholic Church through wars that engulf the world, and one has been canonized a saint. If this is, as some historians call it, the century of the common man, John the 23rd may well go down in history as the Pope with the common touch. For certainly he was close to the people. It was he, more than any other pontiff, who put aside many of the traditional practices that led the rulers of Rome to become known as the prisoner of the Vatican. He often left the confines of the papal city, going outside its walls to take part in ceremony. He went back to the old rite of washing the feet of young priests on Holy Thursday. For generations, popes followed tradition and took their meals alone. John abandoned this and often had guests in for dinner. As a man who welcomed change, he permitted a helicopter to land in a Vatican courtyard. A deep sense of reality stemming from his peasant heritage made him aware of the world's economic problems. As Pope, he blessed such modern devices, seeing even in Soviet spaceships something of value, a blessing for the common man, a thing of good to be used in his trials here on Earth. Now his earthly trial is over. As the 261st Pope, the direct successor to Peter, he now belongs to the Christ whose vicar on earth he was. Pope John did not live to see if Christian reunion was to take place, but his place in history is secure, alongside the ecumenical council he called into being. He will forever be linked with its acts, but he will also be remembered for many other acts of his life, smaller things, but no less indicative of the kind of man he was. With 900 million souls in communist bondage, he named three cardinals in pectore, in his heart, keeping their names secret to save them from reprisal. A gentle and very human pope. He could scold newsmen for trying to learn the secrets of the conclave which elected him, then in the next breath, jokingly admit to them that he enjoyed reading about himself and what he was doing. As pope, he had to sever all ties with his earthly family. The name Roncalli was dropped. But in choosing his papal name of John, he said he took it because it was his father's name, Giovanni. All his life, he was devout and compassionate. In Venice, he was known as the cardinal with the open door. I must think, he said, that whoever is calling on me might also be coming to confess his sins. Jews fleeing Hitler recall him as the man who helped them through Turkey into Palestine. Greeks remember their starving thousands he helped with food. He fought communism and its doctrines, but not its individuals. His appearance was deceiving. Behind the kindly eyes, the shy gestures, the peasant's portly frame, was a skilled diplomat. Diplomacy is bred into my bones, he once remarked, and he could have said that in seven languages. An historian who dealt with facts rather than ideas. Other historians will write of him as a pope who tried to take the idea of Christian unity and make it a fact. He leaves behind a world still struggling toward universal goodwill. He also leaves behind some words of guidance. Be vigilant in the night that is darkening, and ready to defend the principles of Christ against the insidiousness of the enemies of God, even before becoming our enemies.
Tomorrow at 8:30 p.m. Eastern Time, NBC News will bring you a one-hour special evaluation of the work of Pope John and reports via Telstar and relay satellites from Rome.